out, you know, hearing from the angels and going to see the baby Jesus. And at the very end, you know, I mean, you can just imagine the awe and the wonder and the amazement of these shepherds. First of all, these angels, this choir of angels coming in and announcing, you know, the birth of the Messiah. And to shepherds of all people, they did a great job of showing kind of what these shepherds typically were like. And they're the ones that get to come and see the Messiah. The first ones to come and see the Messiah. And as one of the shepherds is walking away, he turns back and he looks and he says, people must know. People must know. And they left. And just as the passage says, when they had seen him, they spread the word concerning him, concerning what had been told to them about the child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherd said to them. And I thought about it and I was like, is that what I'm like? Am I still amazed at the message of the Messiah? You know, at Christmas time, we hear it over and over again, but the message doesn't change. He's still the Messiah for everyone who believes. And it just, for some reason, just seeing that shepherd and hearing him say that, was like, people still must know. You know, just like the shepherds went and told, we need to go and tell people too. So just an encouragement to keep that amazement and that wonder and share it with others. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you once again for your amazing gift of your Son, who was born and given to us as our Messiah to save us from our sins. God, renew in us the wonder and the amazement of not just the message, but of who he is, and help us to share that with others. God, remind us of that truth, even as we worship together this morning. Amen.
I don't think I've ever seen this many sweaters in one place. Oh. And some of them you haven't seen for years. Stand with us. Let's praise the Lord.
Yeah. There is no more for heaven now to give. this I hold, my hope is only Jesus. For my life is wholly bound to His. Oh, how strange and divine I can see. All is mine, yet now I am through Christ in me.
There it is. Happy New Year. Great to see you all. I did something I've never done this weekend. I did not stay up till midnight on New Year's Eve for the first time. I'm not sure how I feel about it. This is a long-standing tradition that I had way too much pride about. But I don't know if I'm getting more boring or older or what, but trying to stamp out I'm just self-reflecting, and you're listening. This is no statement about anyone else. This is just me dealing with my stuff here right in front of you. Just trying to put out the last remaining bits of this cold I'm dealing with. And so me and Caitlin went to bed early, And I think it was worth it. I think it's still the new year, even though I didn't watch it, right? Is that how it works? The calendar still turns over? Okay. We're glad to be here with you today. My name is Joey. I'm the pastor here. Excited about digging into the Word with you this morning. And I do. I really love the new year. I love new beginnings, new seasons, new school years, anything that comes with a new start. I get really excited about it. I kind of just get this hope of what's possible whenever you get to start something new, and I get really excited. So I love turning the calendar over. I really love buying a new paper planner for the year. I do have a calendar on my phone, but I love to write out what's coming up. I really like to make lists of things and get to check them off. So there's something really satisfying about getting to draw that line right through that thing that you accomplished and just feel like, yes, I did it. So I love New Year's. I love setting goals. I like to read blogs and different things, just get people's thoughts on how should we be approaching this new year. I like to take some time to contemplate and think about it. Me and Caitlin have gotten in the habit of, we like to, at the beginning of every new year, look back on the last year and just ask, all right, what happened this year? Let's take some time to remember. What happened in our lives? What did God do in our lives? What can we be thankful for? What was hard? What was fun? But then also look ahead to the next year and set some goals and look ahead and see where we're going. So I love new beginnings. I love the new year. And this week, I read something really thought-provoking from a pastor from New York. His name is Rich Velotis. I don't know if I'm saying that right. But he uses the two contrasting stories of the Tower of Babel in Genesis 11 and God's promises to Abraham in Genesis 12 to show us that there's maybe two different ways we could approach this new year. And I found it captivating, and I want to share that with you this morning as we kind of start in to our sermon today. If you want to follow along, there are notes in your bulletin with blanks and some passages in there, or it'll also be on the screen. So I want to start with the story of the Tower of Babel. It's really short. It's a very brief story. In Genesis 11, it says, "They said to each other, 'Come, let's make bricks and bake them thoroughly.' They used brick instead of stone and tar for mortar. Then they said, 'Come, let us build ourselves a city with a tower that reaches to the heavens so that we may make a name for ourselves.'" There's a little bit more to that story, but essentially all the people of the world, it says at the very beginning, the first couple of verses, are traveling and they settle in this one place and they have this conversation with one another, right? They say to one another, "Come, let's build and make bricks and bake them, and we can make them into something great. We can build it ourselves so it can reach the heavens, so we can make a name for ourselves." So he takes this story and he contrasts it with Genesis 12. And I appreciate this because he points out, it says, they said to each other, they're just having this conversation with one another, right? They say, "Come, let's do this thing all by ourselves. We can do this on our own." And they say, "We can build ourselves something grand. This city, this tower that reaches to the heavens." And they say, "We do this in order that we may make a name for ourselves." So this Pastor Rich, he was pointing out the heart behind this, that they're very self-focused, they're worried about what they can accomplish on their own. But then in the very next chapter, God takes us in the story, this interaction he has with Abraham. And with Abraham, it's different. Paul, if you want to help me out there. With Abraham, it's not them talking to each other. It says God says to Abraham, he speaks to him. And it's not them coming up with what they're going to do. He says, "I will make you. I will tell you. I will show you what it is that you're going to do." And instead of them building this great thing on their own, it says, "I will make you into a great nation. And I will make your name great for God's glory." Not their own name great on their own effort. And we see this contrast, this parallel between these two stories. And I get this. I can relate to this. I can see myself a little bit in the Abraham story and a lot of bit in the Babel story, right? That it's in our nature to be in control, to choose our destiny, to accomplish great things so that we can receive glory, so that we can receive praise and respect from other people. This is just in our nature. We find purpose and validation in our accomplishments. But the problem with that is that those feelings just don't last very long, and we need the next thing, the next accomplishment, the next thing we're going to build so that we can feel worthy again. And it's tiring and tiring. This is how sort of the economy of the world that we live in works, the economy of the flesh, when we choose to interact with the world in our own way. But in God's economy, it's different, and we get these two parallel stories here. And in God's economy, it's different, that in his economy, all we have to do is place our faith and trust in him. We are worthy because he is worthy, because we are his. And in God's economy, we simply ask him, we listen to him, and allow him to work in and through us in our lives. Now, Pastor Rich summarized it like this. He says, when considering these two stories, in short, there are two ways of living. Consider this as you approach the new year. He says, one is creating our own story, trying to build our own name. Or two is finding ourselves in God's story and letting God name us. There's two different paths we can take as we approach this new year. And I spent a lot of time thinking through that, considering what implications it has for my life. Because as I'm making my list, my goals for the year, I get excited. I got my new thing in the mail, you know. I'm writing things in there. And I remembered, I didn't start this goal list with prayer. I didn't come to God and say, God, what do you have for me this year? I just got excited and started writing things down. I wanted to figure out, what is it that I'm going to accomplish? What am I going to do this year? So how is it that we find ourselves in God's story? How do we actually do that? How do we locate ourselves in what God is doing and allow him to use us and to work in our lives? Now, I think a significant part of this, answering that question, is discerning God's will. What does God have for us? And that's a longer conversation that we could have, but it's very challenging. Some of God's will is unique for just us, but so much of God's will is something that's for all of us who claim him as our God, who follow him and trust Jesus as our Savior. And that's presented to us very clearly in his word so that we can see it, so we can know how can we become a part of God's story. We look to his word and we clearly see his will written out there for us. And one way that we can know we're being a part of God's story this year is participate in this mission of disciple making. That's what we're all about at Crossroads. This mission of disciple making. We believe that it's really clear in Scripture what our mission is. So you know, you see it on the front. Well, maybe not on the front, but in our bulletin. We exist to make disciples who love God, grow spiritually, and serve others. It starts with, we exist to make disciples because that's at the center of what we feel God has called us to every single year. So how do I find myself in God's story? I can at the very least start with this idea of being a part of this process of discipleship, disciple making. And at Crossroads, in order to accomplish that piece well, we're going big picture down to details here, we believe that it's important to participate in what we call outreach. This is one of our 10 values at Crossroads. We feel like it's important to do outreach. On our website, you'll find that it says, we believe that God has called us to bring the hope of the cross and the kingdom of God to our families, our neighbors, our community, our region, and to the world. We believe this. God has made this clear to us in his word. We want to reach our families, our neighbors, our community, our region, and the whole world. But how do we do this well? We have a lot of ideas, a lot of thoughts. But one thing we're going to do very intentional this year is for the next 4 weeks, we're going to participate in a community-wide opportunity for outreach. Now, many churches in our community got together, have been working on this over the past year, to just think through how can we band together and reach people who don't know Jesus this year. What would that look like? What could we do? And they came up with this concept, this idea of doing a four-week sermon series that asks some hard questions that people might be wondering about their faith, about God, about Jesus, about the church. And so for the next 4 weeks, we're going to try to answer these questions. Is it reasonable to believe in God? Is Christianity too narrow? How could a loving God allow pain and suffering? How do I know if I'm going to heaven? We're hopeful that these questions are going to engage our family, our neighbors, our community. Engage them with the gospel. Help them to know Jesus. And I know it can be hard when we say the word outreach and we think about disciple making. Sometimes you hear that and you go, oh no, I walked in on that sermon. That's not easy. I don't like doing that. Right? Sometimes it's easy to do the behind the scenes jobs, and I get that. I love doing behind the scenes work. But God also calls us to, in some way, be a part of this mission of disciple making. And this is just one way that our church is going to be intentional about outreach this year. So I invite you into this. You'll find inside your bulletin this morning. There should be. There are extra copies if you need them. But I put two copies of this flyer in your bulletin this morning. One for you and one for a family, a neighbor, a friend, a coworker, whoever it is, that you can share with them, because I know it's hard sometimes. I know it's hard to share the gospel with others, and I encourage you to still do that, to get to know people, to have those conversations. I think those personal interactions and conversations are the number one way people come to know Jesus. When they see him in us, they talk to us, they hear it from us. But as a church, we want to come alongside and say, we want to help you with this and give you an opportunity to just invite someone to come and be a part of a conversation we're all going to have. So I encourage you to find someone, one person in your life, to share this invitation with, to come and to hear this teaching. We're going to have small groups that gather after to continue the conversation so they can come to engage in the gospel with us in hopefully a very personal way. Maybe step one is just coming and being in the room and hearing the teaching and listening. But I think the more meaningful thing is, can we invite people to then come and join us for small group to continue this conversation in a personal way, in a personal context? So this is what we're going to be doing over the next 4 weeks. I'm excited to do this. I'm excited to share this with you. This is going to be a team effort where we invite people, we open up God's word, and we continue that discussion with those that come so that they can come to know who Jesus is. Now, the rest of today, I'll be done with my ad. I want to talk about why. Why would we do this? Why is outreach important? Because I think it's an important question. Why should we spend time on this? Why is it valuable for us as a church? Now, there's a lot of answers we could give to this, and many of them are correct, right? We could say that we want to fill the command God gave us, right? The Great Commission to make disciples. Maybe the angle you come at it is more of, you know, I believe hell is a real place and we don't want people to go there. Or maybe it's you just want to see those lost souls rescued and saved. You know the anguish people are in this life, and you know the comfort and the hope they can find in Jesus. Or maybe it's from a place of you'd really love to see our church grow and more people to come and be a part of this family. I think these are all good answers and all good reasons for outreach. But I also think there's something even more central to why we would want to reach out to others and introduce them to Jesus. I think the reason behind why God gives us this command to make disciples, a really powerful and genuine motivation that he gives us that we can utilize and be reminded of as we seek others and point them to Jesus. That's what I'm going to look at today. Because the thing that I think is most central when we ask this question of why outreach is that Jesus is our treasure. Jesus is our treasure. A relationship with him is the most valuable thing that we can have in this life or in eternity. I think that sometimes we overlook, when we think about outreach, when we think about being rescued, being saved, we overlook Jesus himself as the treasure that he truly is because we get distracted by some of the benefits that come in being in relationship with him. Because yes, knowing Jesus and putting our faith in him does allow us to be in eternity with him. It keeps us from going to a place where we're eternally separated from him. And yes, Jesus makes us into a new creation. He gives us access to the power of the Holy Spirit and rescues us from sin and death. But all of that begins with this knowing him, this relationship with him. And the value of that relationship is greater than anything else that we could achieve, anything else that we could desire or accomplish on our own. So I think the strongest, most helpful motive we can have in pointing others to Jesus is to know that we are pointing them to the most valuable thing they could ever have, which is a relationship with him. And I think the Bible continually points us to this truth. But I think it's made really clear in the most simplest of parables in all of Scripture. It's super short, which I know you'll appreciate. One verse. But also very powerful. That's where we're going to spend our time this morning, is Matthew 13:44. It simply says this. The kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field. When a man found it, he hid it again. And then in his joy went and sold all he had and bought that field. It's amazing how much is pushed in to this one line, this one sentence in Scripture, this one story that Jesus tells us. When I first read this, when I first hear this, I think, Okay, there are different types of spenders in the world, right? There's a man that found this thing and he spent all that he had. And I started thinking about that and processing that. And I go, all right, I know there's different types of spenders, right? There's penny pinchers. And then there's people who on the other end just don't even know how much money's in their account and spend and don't worry about it, right? And everything in between. I tend to be a little bit more on the conservative side, but I still have the occasion for impulse buys, especially on Taco Tuesday. What are you going to do? It's so hard to say no. Now, large purchases always make me a little uncomfortable because they feel a little riskier. Like, this is a bigger thing? Is this going to work out? Is this a good deal? Should I be doing this? So I get a little uneasy about these larger purchases, and this passage says that he spent everything that he had. So it's really hard for me to imagine how he did this. How at one time, on one thing, on anything, you could spend every single thing that you have. There would have to be absolutely no doubt in my mind that the value of that thing is at least much, much more valuable than what I'm spending on it, because it would feel kind of risky. And that's just one of the things that makes this story so interesting, so captivating for us. But also that the man doesn't seem to question it at all, right? When a man found it, he hid it, and then in his joy, he went and sold all he had and bought the field. He doesn't seem to question it at all. He doesn't see it as a risk. He says, in my joy, I went and gave all I had for what I found, this treasure in the field. In his joy, he did this. Not in hopes of working it out or with confidence or after prayerful consideration. It says he saw the treasure. He was so overjoyed to have discovered it. He realized what it was. So he immediately went and gave up everything he had so that he could purchase it. I think this is incredible. I think it brings us to our first truth this morning that we uncover in the scripture, which is Jesus is the treasure of treasures. Jesus is the treasure of treasures. I found a quote from an author, co-founder of Desiring God, that helped us to unpack this a little bit more. He says, eternal life is more about a person than a place. What will make the kingdom of heaven so heavenly to us will not be the glorious phenomena of the new creation or the rich rewards we receive, as inexpressibly wonderful as they will be. But the heaven of the age to come, the treasure of treasures, will be God himself, knowing and being with the one from whom all blessings flow. That is a reframing of what we're pursuing for some of us when we come to know Jesus, when we come to follow him. It's so easy to have our eyes set on some of the benefits, the rewards, the things that are going to come, but the true treasure at the center of all of it is God himself, knowing him, being known by him, the source of all blessing. God himself is the treasure. Jesus is the treasure. And everything we might accomplish or acquire here on earth or in heaven has so much less value than a relationship with God, with Jesus. Just like hell is a terrible place because it means this eternal separation, this eternal distance from God. Heaven is wonderful and glorious because it means this eternal existence in the presence of God, being with him. Jesus even says this himself, that knowing him is the real treasure, the real value of eternal life when we think about it. In John 17, he says, Jesus is speaking to the disciples. He's in prayer before God. They're present. They're listening. And he says, now this is eternal life, that they know you, speaking of God, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. He's praying for the disciples. This is near the end of John, near the end of his time on earth. He's praying for them. He's seeking something for them. And he says, this is eternal life, that they know you, that they know me. Jesus understands that the true treasure is to be in relationship with him. And he prays for that, for the disciples and for all of us. I think it's interesting, as I was reflecting on this, there's so many places in Scripture where our relationship with God is compared to marriage, right? It's hard for us sometimes to understand how this relationship with God works and what it looks like. So the Bible uses metaphors all the time to help us see so clearly who God is and how we interact with him. And marriage is one of the common expressions of that, the common metaphors to help us to understand. When I think about marriage, I know that many people pursue marriage for some of the benefits it brings, right? We avoid loneliness. There's some tax breaks, affords us an opportunity to have children. Some other fun things help you have children, right? There's some benefits to being in this relationship. But the longer you're married, the more you realize the true benefit is the relationship that you have, the relationship you've gained, having someone in your life who knows you more intimately than anyone else and loves you more deeply and more sacrificially than anyone else. The true treasure, the true value is in the relationship, and God wants us to see that. Jesus isn't the savior of our blessings. He's the savior of our souls. Jesus isn't the savior of our blessings. He's the savior of our souls. He's definitely the source of our blessings, don't get me wrong, but he doesn't invite us to follow him just so that we can have our best life now, right? Jesus himself is the treasure of treasures, and he invites us to know him and to be known by him. Now, the second thing this morning, we can see clearly from Paul as he helps us to understand this idea, the implications of Jesus being our treasure in Philippians 3. He says this when he's reflecting on this idea. He says, but whatever were gains to me, I now consider loss for the sake of Christ. What is more, I consider everything a loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things. I consider them garbage that I may gain Christ. That is a strong statement. That is a hard one to process. Now, before this, Paul talked about all the different ways that he is basically an outstanding human being, one that would be looked upon very positively by God based on the standards of the religion that he grew up in, right? Paul explains that he was born on the right day and all these other things that lead up to him being one who has earned his place and his standing, if there was such a way to do that. That more than anyone else, he can have confidence in the flesh, in his own accomplishments, his own abilities. But instead, after knowing Jesus and interacting with him and seeing what he can do for him, he says that everything he's accomplished, everything he's acquired in life, everything he's done, as great and marvelous as it is, he considers garbage compared to knowing Jesus. That is an amazing statement. So the second truth that I feel like comes to the surface as we unpack this together this morning is that the treasure comes at a cost. The treasure comes at a cost. In order to gain Christ, Paul gave up his position in society. He gave up his success. He gave up what he knew, what he was comfortable with. Everything that he'd built, everything he put an effort towards, everything he'd crossed off in his to-do list, every goal he had set in life up till this moment, he chose to follow Jesus, everything was left behind. Paul walked away from himself in order to have the treasure of knowing Jesus. It's an amazing statement. But if we really think about it, if we really weigh these things against receiving Jesus' love and grace, gaining eternal life in the kingdom of God, and becoming a new creation, Paul's trying to make it so crystal clear to us, it's not even a question. There shouldn't be a question in our mind. We shouldn't have any doubt. In our joy, we should go and be willing to set everything aside for the blessing and honor of knowing Jesus. The scales don't balance in this equation. There's not risk. The value of following Jesus is infinitely greater than the value of whatever it is that we can create or we can acquire or we can accomplish on our own. I think I've shared this here before. You may be familiar with this, but I can't help but go back to it because it just blows my mind. And maybe even more astonishing is that Tom Brady still plays football, somehow, and at a high level. But early in his career, when he had won 3 Super Bowls, he famously did an interview where he talked about all his accomplishments, and they asked him about everything, and they said, "What's next?" And he looked back at the interview, and he just simply said, "I don't know. There's got to be more than this, though, right?" Like, almost in a question form. Like, I'm on the mountaintop, And it just feels like there's got to be something more than this in this world. There's got to be more. And Tom is right. There's so much more. And it's okay to look at everything we've done and everything we have and accomplished and go, should there be something more? Ecclesiastes alludes to this. It says, I denied myself nothing my eyes desired. I refused my heart no pleasure. My heart took delight in all my labor, and this was the reward for all my toil. Yet when I surveyed all that my hands had done and what I had toiled to achieve, everything was meaningless, a chasing after the wind. Nothing was gained under the sun. Now, I realize I've hit this drum really hard here, so I want to put a little caveat in here. Work is good. God made it. He created us to work. He created us to create. He created us to accomplish things. There's nothing wrong with being productive, accomplishing, being creative, doing the work that God has set before us. God made these things, and these are good. Our labor, our creation helps support families. It helps people in need. It enriches the world. God made this world for us to live in and enjoy and take part in, and work is good. But in and of itself, and here's the line between, in and of itself, this work, these accomplishments cannot save us. They will not make us good enough. They will not fulfill us. They will not be enough on their own. So when we talk about this idea that treasure comes at a cost, I don't say it lightly because I know how significant that cost can feel to us. In order to follow Jesus, put our faith in him, God asks us to be willing to sacrifice everything we are and everything that we have. And it can feel costly because these things are personal. We've been a part of them. But Paul is saying that if we stack up all these things, everything we've done and known and seen and created next to knowing Jesus, Jesus is immeasurably more valuable than anything stacked on the other side. Anything we've done, accomplished, created. Jesus is immeasurably more valuable. Right? Paul says it like this: whatever were gains to me, I now consider lost for the sake of Christ. I think about it in terms of, you know, I go back to this large purchase idea. Because this guy sold everything he had, right? This year we bought a new house. And it's really hard to sign that paperwork and sign, write that check, because you're like, oh man, what is going on right now? Is this a good idea? Right? But I think, what if I came to that table and I stacked everything up I had versus the value of what I was to gain, and they said, this isn't going to cost you however many thousands of dollars. This is going to cost you one of your old socks. And I'd be like, really? Okay, this is a no-brainer. There's no risk in this, right? Paul's trying to help us see that on one side of the scale, with all of our accomplishments and everything done, on the other side of the scale being Jesus, it's not even a question. Knowing Jesus, being in relationship with him, following him is so great. It doesn't mean there's no value here, but he's saying, I am so great, I'm so wonderful. Knowing me is not even a question. You'd be willing to set aside it all if I ask you to. Trust me, follow me. I am the way to true satisfaction in this life. I am the real treasure. Yes, this treasure may come at a cost, it may feel costly, but it's absolutely worth it. Knowing Jesus is so valuable, Paul wants us to see that it's a no-brainer. Jesus is our treasure, and yes, it comes at a cost. But then we get to this third part. This last part of Philippians 3 is Paul is talking, taking this idea of Jesus as our treasure and asking, how does this impact our lives? And he says this in verse 10. He says, I want to know Christ, yes, to know the power of his resurrection, participation in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, and so somehow attaining to the resurrection from the dead. Not that I've already obtained all this or have already arrived at my goal, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. I love these three verses, because we get to hear the heart of Paul. Why would Paul say what he said in verse 7 and 8? What's going on inside of him in his heart? And he reveals that to us here. We see Paul as a follower of Jesus who counted the cost, left everything behind, and now is in pursuit to know Christ as well as he can, as deeply as he can. Paul understands so clearly, with laser focus, that Jesus is the treasure. He understands the value of knowing him as well as one can. Although he would say he has a ways to go. He understands that to follow Jesus, to know him, to trust him, is to become like him in death by leaving the old behind and being made new. He says it at the beginning, right? To become like him in death, to understand the death. He understands that Jesus took hold of him so that he could take hold of Jesus and the eternal life that comes with knowing him. But Paul's central desire, his heart that comes through on these pages, is to know Jesus as well as he can. And he's going to continue to strive towards that every single day. If you go on to read verse 13 and 14, he talks about the prize for which he strives for. We sang about it in our last song this morning. So what comes to the surface here as I read this, as I hear his heart? I hear from Paul that our motivation matters. What's in our heart, what pushes us forward, what our desires are, these things matter greatly. And not just in outreach in this one area, in all areas of our life. Where our heart is pointed, where it's pushing us towards, matters greatly. And Paul makes it really clear, it should be pointing us towards Jesus. So we go back, we circle back to this conversation. Why do we value outreach? Why does God command us to make disciples? Yes, he wants us to honor his commands. He wants us to prevent people from spending eternity apart from him. And yes, we should want to see our church grow, but ultimately, what it boils down to, the central thing, is that we should want people to have the treasure that we have, to know Jesus, to have him be at the center of their lives. I think if we're only motivated by people, by wanting people to avoid being eternally separated from God, then we might be tempted to take shortcuts. We might stop caring after they say a prayer committing their life to Jesus, or in some cases, we may not notice that their declaration of faith was not genuine or they didn't fully understand. But if we're dedicated to helping people know Jesus, grow in their relationship with him, walk side by side, step by step with them, and experience more of him, experience the fullness of the treasure, if that's our aim, if that's our motivation, then we're so much more likely to help them truly understand who Jesus is and the treasure that he is in their life. So what do we do with this? The first step is we should desire Jesus. He is the real treasure above everything else in our lives. Now, I know you've heard this before. This is maybe not a new concept. Great, Pastor, you tell me to desire Jesus. But that's hard sometimes. I don't feel like it, right? I don't feel like praying, reading my Bible, whatever it is. How do I increase my desire? Step one, come to God in prayer and say, God, I want to desire to know you, to follow you, to deepen my relationship with you, but I'm struggling with it right now. Be honest with him. He wants to have that relationship with you. Ask him for help. He will come alongside. He will help you to grow your desire for him. Spend time in his word, even if it's his word adjacent. Right, sometimes we think, well, I've got to get out my 365 Bible and I have to read the two chapters a day or it's not good enough, right? And that is great. If you want to read the Bible in a year, whatever your reading plan is, being in God's word, knowing him is wonderful. But I know sometimes you get in a rut, sometimes it's hard. It's okay, take some time, use a tool. We have so many wonderful tools in 2022. We have devotionals. We have right now media, we have podcasts, we have reading plans that people lay out for us, we have the Bible Project on YouTube, we have study Bibles, we have small groups, we have friends, we have people in our life that can come alongside us. We don't have to do this alone. But being in God's Word helps us to know his will for our lives, helps us to see and understand his heart for us, helps us to fall in love with him more when we spend time reading about him, studying him, knowing him. But know yourself and know what's going to help you to get there, and any step you take closer to him is a helpful step. Don't be too hard on yourself. And the last thing is, I found that when we serve others and we think outside of ourselves, right, we're answering this question, how do we grow in our desire for Jesus? I encourage you to come find a situation where you can serve others and see God at work. That's one of my favorite things about going to Awana, and listening to the kids come and share their memory verses with me, and come walk up and they share what they've learned and they're excited, and sometimes they understand it and sometimes they don't and they have questions. But every single time I do it as a listener and I come and I hear, I see God working in their lives. I see God at work. I get a front row seat. When you come alongside to serve someone else, you get to see God at work in real life. The second question, or the second thing for us this morning is, I think we should help as many people as possible to share in this treasure. This is not a treasure that's limited. It's unlimited. It's for all of us. It's not something to hoard. It doesn't have less value when someone else has it. It has, I think, increased value the more people that get to know it and participate in it. There's enough Jesus to go around, enough for everyone. And if he is the very best thing you could have and the very best thing that you can experience, why would we keep that to ourselves? I think this is central to our motivation of outreach. To love like Jesus is to point others to the treasure that we are enjoying in knowing him. I encourage you, grow in your desire for Jesus this year, your relationship with him, pursue him, and help as many people as possible to participate in that treasure. That's why we're taking time this next month. We want to invite people to come and be a part of this conversation. We want to introduce them to their Savior, their rescuer, their treasure. And we're going to come to a time of communion this morning. We come to the Lord's table. We come to remember the sacrifice he made, the price he paid on our behalf, but also to remember that he is our true treasure. We want to keep our eyes focused on Jesus at all times. Now, we take communion regularly because we don't want to forget these things. We want to keep our eyes fixed on Jesus as our treasure. We want to take some time right now as we do this, as we go through this process, to remember him, to refocus on him, to repent of the things that we're trying to find hope and fulfillment in our lives. So I encourage you to remember who Jesus is. I'm going to give you a moment to reflect. Remember who he is. Repent of the things that you've been putting in his place. And refocus on Jesus as your Savior. This is why we come to the Lord's table. This is why he gave us the gift of communion, that we could come to remember and never forget who he is and what he's done for us. After we take a couple minutes to do that, we're going to take this bread and this cup together in remembrance of who our Savior is. If you didn't grab a cup yet, there's some out just outside that door on the counter there. Go ahead and take a couple minutes to reflect. night he was betrayed. Broken for you, do this in remembrance. The same way he took the cup, he said, "This is my blood poured out for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we thank you that you are our treasure. That you love us so much. That you seek us out. That you pursue us. That you help yourself to be known, to be found and discovered. God, help us to never forget who you are and the value that you have in our lives. Or as we come to sing this final song, "How Great You Are," Lord, I pray that we would come with hearts of thanksgiving and praise and be continually reminded of the value that you have in our lives. In your name, amen. Please stand and sing with us.
Savior God, to thee.
We do have coffee today, but it is out in the lobby, not downstairs where it is cold. It is warm up here. We did stay a few minutes extra, but you didn't want to go outside, right? You want to stay in here where it's warm. My prayer for you this year is that you would find yourself in God's story. You'd find yourself in God's story. You'd consider what it is that he has for you this year. And join us in this mission that God has called us to of making disciples together. God, we pray to that end this morning that you would make us people that walk step in step with you, that see you for the true value and treasure that you are. And out of that, we look to find ourselves in your story and participate in what you have for us. God, we ask that it would be so. In your name, amen. Have a wonderful week.